We begin our day out in the depths of the English countryside. And when I say depths, I really do mean depths. This quite amazing place at Monkton Farley, once top secret, has recently been opened up to the public.
I'm all of 100 feet underground here in what was the largest underground ammunition depot in Europe during the Second World War. It's a bomb-proof honeycomb of chambers and corridors, many of them like this one, more than a quarter of a mile long. They've even got one here that's a full mile long. It's a bit like being on the set of a science fiction movie, isn't it? But it's all real enough, and although it's very peaceful and quiet now, at the height of the war, this whole place was alive and bustling with people taking delivery of ammunition, storing it, and then dispatching it to our armed forces all over the world. Nick McCanley and his wife Vicky were responsible for putting all of this on the tourist map. Nick, why did the government choose a place like this as an ammunition depot?
Oh, because of the depth here. We were, before the Second World War, completely impervious to any enemy bombardment. It was just the safest place, much safer than surface storage.
And it is huge, isn't it?
Oh, it's immense, yeah. It's over 80 acres under here.
And you've got a map, I think, that'll give us some idea of how big it is. All the chambers and the passages.
Yes, you can see here is the main entrance building we use.
Mm-hmm.
Just into the main area alone, you've got over 50 acres, a quarter of a mile each way here,
mm-hmm.
and tunnels leading off. Well, there's a tunnel here that leads right the way down to the main on-railway box, where you've got an underground marshalling yard where the ammunition came in. This conveyor belt runs all the way through that. And something like, I think, 4.5 miles of rubber conveyor belts down here. And the railway system here, miles of railway. It's enormous. It's a very sophisticated place.
It's also very cold and very damp down here. How do they keep the ammunition dry?
Oh, it's cold and damp now, but during the war, there was probably what was the most sophisticated air conditioning system in the world at its time.
And you've managed to get some of it still working, haven't you, with that huge fan?
Oh, yes, we have some of the fans working occasionally. They're very, very expensive to run now.
Why did you think to open a place like this to the public?
Because it's so important. It's been neglected for 10 years or more now. It's the largest underground ammunition depot in Europe, probably in the world. In fact, they spent so much money on the place that by 1942, there were questions asked in the Houses of Parliament about it. No, I mean, they spent £71 million, like, by 1942.
Good Lord.
Mm.
So what do people think when they come down and see £71 million worth of junk?
Junk? they're amazed. Most people go out and
well, probably at the time it was money very well spent, actually.
Oh, yes.
Well, that sort of place certainly makes you appreciate fresh air and wide open spaces. But now to Bath itself, one of the loveliest cities in the world. The magnificent Abbey is the centerpiece of this great show place. And round it, there are always people drinking in the almost festive atmosphere. And there's no doubt there's plenty to see. For a start, there's usually a variety of street entertainers. Coming to Bath in droves for 300 years, ever since Richard Nash, a gambler from Carmarthen, became Beau Nash, the so-called King of Bath. He excelled in the field of public relations and managed to turn the city into a fashionable resort. It never looked back, and now every year it welcomes more and more guests. So, where do people go when they come to Bath? Well, the principal attraction is right next to the Abbey, the Baths, built by the Romans as part of a large temple complex. Built here, of course, because of the hot spring waters. They gush out at a rate of 250,000 gallons a day. And the flow of visitors is pretty impressive too. They come at the rate of 1 million a year, which makes this one of the most popular tourist attractions in Britain. The story of how the baths were discovered by chance only a century ago has become part of Bath's folklore.
The city engineer was called in to investigate damp in some of the houses built up there, if you can believe it, where we now see open sky. He drilled hell holes down and discovered the lead on the bottom of the pool.
People also learn how the Romans came here to bathe and to worship the goddess Sulis Minerva, to whom the sacred spring was dedicated. And they can sample the water itself, which was always thought to have special healing properties. Cheeky little vintage. Maybe just a twist of lemon? There are colourful reminders everywhere that Bath has won numerous national and international awards as a floral city. But above all, the visitor sees a Georgian city. This is one of the highlights, the Royal Crescent, 200 yards of restrained, elegant, and unified architectural design, created by John Wood the Younger and completed in 1774. Then there's Lansdowne Crescent higher up the hill, embellished with wrought iron lamp holders. So the buildings of Bath are something to enjoy in their own right. And there are plenty of marvellous museums too. This one is the Camden Works Museum. And when you go inside, you find it's very different.
If you have a garage, I wonder if it's anything like mine. Absolutely chock-a-block of all the bits and pieces that we've put in there, because one day they just might come in handy. Well, this place is a bit like that. These shelves behind me are absolutely stuffed full of the most extraordinary bits and pieces. Look at this, for instance. It's a wee hook on which you would hang a fob watch. This is an old-fashioned bell pull, and an anatomist syringe. There's a brass tap for hot water, of course, and a steam engine whistle. There you are. Can't get any noise out of it now. And this wonderful old-fashioned telephone. You won't find them like that in the telecom shops these days. And these are a set of keys for picking locks. Now, they could come in very handy. And what about this? It's a light bulb for the blackouts. Well, this, these, and dozens of other things are all here and were all kept because they just might have been in demand one day.
They were all part of the stock of a business run from this gaslit office, a business that had been founded locally by one Jonathan Burdett Bowler in 1872. It closed its books for the last time in 1969. And although the premises were then demolished, all the thousands and thousands of items that had never been thrown away by Mr. Bowler or his descendants were saved. And they were found a home here in what was originally a real tennis court. Mr. Bowler had a wide range of interests. Principally, though, he was an engineer. And the old machines used in that side of his business are, I am happy to report, still in slick working order. He also ran a brass foundry, the activities of which are regularly recreated here. For demonstration purposes, however, they now use aluminium. In addition, Mr. Bowler was a mineral water manufacturer, and this is where he mixed water, limestone, and sulfuric acid to produce the fizz, carbon dioxide. It was collected in the vat up at the top. He actually devised his own flavours, but most of his mixtures included an ingredient called twaddle, a kind of sugary syrup invented by a certain Mr. Twaddle. And there are bottles filling every available corner.
Well, this is where you can see how the bottles were filled. And not surprisingly, the machine that provided the carbon dioxide, that's it, was invented by Mr. Bowler himself. And it must have been a pretty good bit of engineering because he built it in 1875 and it was in use right up until 1969. This is the machine that actually did the bottling, and it was called a Paragon turnover. Turnover because you popped the bottle in there upside down, held it in place by that wooden block, and then literally turned the whole thing over. And gradually, the bottle would fill up with a mixture of carbonated water, which would come in through these pipes through here, and a great dollop of syrup that came out of this thing. And then the bottle could be taken out of its container, and the gas that was in here would force its way down onto that little marble stopper, which is right in the neck, and actually hold that in place so that it would be a proper airtight stopper for the bottle. This one's going to drip a little bit because they don't use gas these days, because these machines are so ancient it would probably be a wee bit hazardous. There we are, and it's fallen out already, in fact. And when you wanted to drink, you just put that little marble out of the way by holding it in that part of the bottle. I don't know if you can see it, but there's a wee pinch in the glass there, and the marble stays in place so the liquid comes out. It's a lot of fun, isn't it? Maybe they should reinvent these kind of bottles.
Just down the road are the assembly rooms where you can find the Museum of Costume. Based on a collection built up by one woman, Doris Langley Moore, it's one of the largest and most comprehensive costume collections in the world. This court dress, made of silk woven with a metal thread, is the star of the show, as it's managed to survive from the time of Charles II. It's the rarest and the earliest of a series of sumptuous exhibits which illustrate fashion all the way through from the 17th century to the present day. Most of the famous residents of Bath are remembered by plaques on the buildings they lived in. But in Great Pulteney Street, there's one that informs us that someone dictated a book there. He was William Smith, the father of English geology, a title he earned because of his work in the countryside around Bath.
This is one of the few signs of the old Somerset Coal Canal, and even then, it's not all that visible, is it? But if you know what you're looking for, believe me, it really is there, and you can see the gentle curve of the canal as it winds along the edge of the valley and down through the trees. Well, if you still don't believe that underneath all that undergrowth there really is an old canal, well, there's a photograph just to prove it. And that shows exactly what it used to look like, the line of the canal and the old mill next to it. Now, in 1793, William Smith was asked to survey the proposed line of the canal. And he liked this part of the country so much that he bought a house here at Tucking Mill, near the Midford Brook, right on the edge of the canal itself, and he made it his home for the next 20 years. But amusingly, the plaque that tells us that he lived here is on the wrong house, because he didn't live in this little cottage at all, but in a house a few hundred yards further away on the side of the hill.
Well, the canal may have gone, but there's still some water here. A lake fed by the Midford Brook, and it's been turned into a most attractive fishing area with facilities for the disabled. Smith did some of his research in this very valley, so it's a good place to find out more about him. Diana Smith, no relation incidentally, is the curator of the Bath Geology Museum.
Dana, what was so very special and important about William Smith's work?
He was one of the pioneer geologists of the early part of the last century, and involved in studying the rocks for his line in the canal. And from that work, he recognised that rock units repeated themselves, and he recognised and collected fossils from each of these, and actually wrote down this sequence and drew the information onto maps. And that was really the important thing. He wrote it all down.
But what was it that he actually saw that was so important, that told him so much?
Gosh, difficult one. But really, as we can see here, the different rock bands, a hard band here with softer, shaly horizons in between. And you can see that going on up, and they get more rubbly and sort of broken up at the top. And he would recognise fossils in each of them and could tell what might be happening in rock units further down. There might be the coal measures or a good building stone, things like that.
He made some very interesting maps too, didn't he? Let's have a look at the one that you brought.
Yes, this is a map of a round bath, a circular map that was already in existence, and he's put onto it the various rock units. The yellow here is the bath stone, and the blue underneath it is the what we call the lias, which is units of softer rocks, of clays and shales. And then underneath again, this red unit called the trias. And this is what you would see if you cleared off all the topsoil and the buildings, the outcrop of the rocks.
Well, presumably, if Smith was so clever at being able to discover where there was going to be building stone or coal, this made him quite a rich man, did it?
No, unfortunately it didn't. And he still hasn't got the sort of true recognition for his work today. But he did try. He opened a quarry of his own in Buildingstone, just up the valley. But his little venture didn't work, and he had to sell up and move away.
Overlooking the valley of the Midford Brook a bit further along, there's a castle. Midford Castle, however, is triangular, and that's a sure sign that it's not a real one. Charming, though. The George Inn at Norton St. Philip is an ancient building. It's medieval, and it's one of the most famous inns in the country. It was originally built as a hostelry for pilgrims by the monks of nearby Hinton Priory. But it wasn't just an inn. The monks built the large overhanging top story as an area to store, buy, and sell wool, and this made Norton St. Philip an important centre for the wool trade. And as you might expect, this historic inn has had some famous guests.
In June of 1685, during his rebellion, Monmouth brought his troops to Norton St. Philip, and he made his temporary headquarters here in the George. They had a battle in and around the village, which actually went very well for Monmouth. But there's a story which says that at one point he put his head out of one of these windows and someone took a shot at him. It was more than likely a bounty hunter who was after the reward that had been put on his head. The bullet missed, but it wouldn't have changed the course of history very much, even if he had been shot, because Monmouth was to die anyway within a matter of weeks at the hands of the executioner. Another famous person to have stayed at the George was the diarist, Samuel Pepys, though he came in rather more peaceful times. In that famous journal of his, he noted that on June the 12th, 1668, he, his wife and his servants all dined very well for 10 shillings.
The villages to the south of Bath are steeped in history and tradition. At Falkland, there's even a relic of crime and punishment from the days of yore. This is Kilmersdon, and you couldn't hope to find a more typical English village. And yet here they have a most unexpected claim to fame. They believe that the village inspired a story known to every man, woman, and especially child in the country. They say that this was the very hill that Jack and Jill climbed in the nursery rhyme. Well, it's certainly a long and steep one. They climbed the hill to fetch a pail of water from a well. And here it is. Though, actually, it's a fake, built with the nursery rhyme in mind. For safety, the real one is protected by a concrete slab. The beautiful countryside to the southwest of Bath was once a working coalfield. The last mine was closed down just a few years ago, but reminders still shape the horizon. And in Radstock, a rescued pit wheel has been given pride of place. Well, from an industry that's disappeared to an old craft newly imported from America, the carving of duck decoys, a skill that spawned specialist magazines and international competitions. Here at Farrington Gurney, you can find an enthusiastic band learning techniques at the only school of its kind in the country. It's run by Britain's leading exponent, Bob Ridges, and he explains how the art form began.
Well, it all started with hunting decoys. This is an example of an old American hunting decoy, and it was floated on the water, usually anchored out on a point of land, and it attracted other flying ducks to come down within range of the hunter's gun, or in very early times, the Red Indians' bow and arrows, the Indians who really thought this idea up in the first place, making theirs from bundles of reeds. But the early settlers, with better tools, made them from wood.
Well, now they've become very much collector's items, and indeed the sort of things that you do are now all done for commission and not used for hunting at all, are they?
No, they're now works of art, and people collect them as they would pictures. These, in fact, are ducks which are made by students at our school here, and they are very good, but some of them are not exactly feather perfect, but they're well on the way.
How do you start on a project like that?
Well, right at the beginning, just to teach people how to use the knife safely, we give them a piece of wood like this, and we get them to carve a wooden egg. If they can carve the wooden egg safely, then there's no reason why they can't carve the duck. This is the starting point on the duck. The bandsawn blank already looks quite a bit like a duck. In fact, quite a lot of work has gone into producing it to this stage. We have to go out and observe ducks, draw them, make a pattern, and then two of the three dimensions can be actually profiled into the block of wood so that the student starts off with a ready shaped duck, and they just have to carve in the third dimension. Yes. This is a Malayan wood called jelutong, and it's a very, very suitable wood for beginners to carve because although it's a hard wood, it has a very uniform grain, and so they can carve it quite easily using just a simple handicraft knife and sandpaper, and then they go on and paint it, and if they're going to do a feather-textured duck, then they use a burning tool to put the texture on.
Well, I think I'd like to have a go at you doing feathers. Before I do, just tell me something about the sort of prices that are paid now. I mean, this one is very old, an original American. What would that be?
Yes, this one is one which I've had for some years, and its present value is, I suppose, in the region of £1,500. But
for a lump of wood?
Well, for a lump of wood, but with a certain grace, a certain appeal. But if I tell you that just a few weeks ago, a single decoy fetched $319,000 at auction in America, it gives you some idea of the collectability of these old decoys.
Good luck. I think I'd better start learning to do them a bit fast.
Yes, maybe there's...
Pass me the iron.
Maybe there's money in it.
Exactly.
Now, use the burner just like a pen and mark the quill first. That's very good.
Oh, it wiggles.
Yes, just... And then mark the barbs on each side of the quill to make the feather. Keep them as close together as possible. That's very good. Not quite so quickly because it's a burning tool, so it needs time to burn.
Ah, so...
That's better, much better.
No pressure.
No pressure. Yeah, that's very good. You'd be good at this, Angela.
I shall be making my first £500,000 duck in no time.
Beep, beep, beep.
Well, one place where you'll always find the real version of our feathered friends is right in the centre of Bath, at the weir just below Pulteney Bridge. And from here, you can take a boat trip up the river. It takes you past Pulteney Bridge itself onto a stretch of river that can't really be seen at its best in any other way. I called it a boat trip, but really it feels more stately than that. And it gives one the opportunity just to stand and stare and enjoy the scenery. So, with a certain amount of surprise that such a picturesque stretch of river exists, virtually unknown in the centre of the city, I've disembarked at the Bath boating station, leaving the other passengers to continue their voyage on to the higher reaches of the river. Here they have a selection of traditional craft, well worth a closer inspection. And I can add one last thing to my schedule, because the setting and the occasion seem just right for it.
Well, we've got the river and a very pleasant summer's evening. All the ingredients for a bit of English eccentricity. I'm going to take to the River Avon in a punt. And I'm going to take my coat off to this one because, as the man who owns this lovely old Victorian boating station says, it's a bit like going to sea in a box. Never done this before, so absolutely anything could happen. So man the lifeboats and let's be off, shall we? Oh, that's a cheat's way of doing it, isn't it? It's supposed to be very relaxing, this. It's not supposed to do that.